touch the world. But it couldn't fill me. Melt empty praise and treasures of fame are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied.
It's a joy to be able to be here with you this morning. We just want to welcome you to our live stream here on YouTube at Crossroads Baptist Church. My name is Michael Evans. I'm the student pastor here. It's a joy to be able to do the announcements with you this morning. Real quick, I just want to just share a few things with you. If this is your first time watching us online and you have a prayer request, please submit your prayers to prayers@crossroadsbaptist.org. Again, prayer@crossroadsbaptist.org, and we can pray for you. If you're a first-time viewer, we'd love to get information from you as well, where we can try to contact you. We'd love to just be able to send something to you. Students, I just wanted to just make a few announcements real quick. Parents and youth, please be looking for emails that has your scheduled D-group Zoom times for your D-group calls. Sunday nights at 6 o'clock, we do Facebook Live. And then on Thursday nights, we do a Zoom call at 7:30. We're doing a study on control. And the theme of it is, what is controlling you? What is controlling you right now? What's controlling you right now in your life? Please make sure students are doing their Zoom calls, please. Parents, if you would, please look at these emails. Make sure your students are on their D calls, their Zoom calls for their D groups. That's very important. Listen, if you have any questions whatsoever about Zoom calls, what we're doing, our Facebook Live or whatever, don't hesitate to send me an email. at michael@crossroadsbaptist.org or call me on my cell phone. Even though we're not here in this building, we're still doing student ministry, and I'm available, and I want to be able to minister to our students and minister to your parents as well. And so this morning, we're just going to go to the Lord in prayer. What a great group we have behind us here leading us in worship. And just they're going to continue to lead us in worship. And then I'm so thankful for a pastor that preaches the word without any exceptions at all. He just preaches it for what it means. We'll hear him in just a few minutes. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, as we come to you right now, Lord, we thank you for this day. God, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we thank you for even times like now that we don't have a clue what's going on, the uncertainty of things, Lord. We know that you're faithful, God, that you're in control. And God, I pray that today, Lord, if we have first-time viewers that's watching us on live stream this morning, God, I pray that these songs of worship that we have here will just speak to their hearts. Lord, I pray as our pastor opens up the Word of God here in a little bit, that the Holy Spirit would just start speaking to them and show them something today that they can take and implement in their own lives to help them to be a better Jesus follower for you. God, today is all about you. Lord, it's not about any of us. It's all about you. So, Lord, I pray today you would hide our pastor behind the cross as he preaches the word. Be with our praise team as they lift us in praise and worship because you are the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. Lord, we love you. God, we thank you for all that you do for us. We pray all this in Jesus' name.
I can hardly think as you fall. me deeper still as you call me deeper still as you call me deeper still into love.
Help me to rid my endless fears. Building with the rest of our church family, Father, we can still worship together from wherever we are this morning. God, I thank you for the truth of your word. God, I thank you that our belief in your word is what holds us through what we're going through now. God, I pray that you'll be with our pastor as he comes to bring the word that you've given him. Lord, I pray that he will speak with boldness. I pray that he will speak with the full authority of the Holy Spirit through speaking through your word through him, Father. God, may our ears and hearts and minds be receptive to what it is you have to say to us. And we ask all this in Jesus' holy and precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, amen. Amen. If your heart has been blessed already by the music this morning in our worship, hey, we turn to the person sitting next to you and say, amen, to God be the glory. Amen, to God be the glory. We are so blessed to have such a wonderful praise band, a praise team that leads us in worship every single week, and we praise God for them. Hey, take your Bibles with me this morning, and let's do church. Let's be the church. Let's open up our Bibles, and maybe you've got a notepad you want to get out, and let's study God's Word together. I ask you to turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. You know, while we're walking by faith and not walking in fear, there's a term that keeps coming up from time to time, and I've used it myself, and that term is what we are experiencing as we try to describe everything is we're using this term called birth pains. Birth pains. So we're dealing with the coronavirus, and with the coronavirus, we've been introduced to social distancing. We have states now that are on lockdown. And my goodness, the politics of all of this, unfortunately, there seems to be a strategy or a policy, if you would, of scorched earth. And so we're asking ourselves, what does all of this mean? We're noticing financial upheaval, the closures of businesses, the loss of jobs. And ladies, as I talk about birth pains this morning, I want to apologize in advance because as a man, I've never experienced the birth pains. But as I bring this up, I want you to know that I certainly don't make light of the subject, but I do want you to know that it's Jesus himself who begins to talk about the events that will be leading up to end times. As you see on your screen, there's an opening screen, and the title is The Delay, Return, and Judgment of King Jesus. And what we're going to be studying, and by the way, I don't know if this is just going to be a sermon series, or maybe as the Lord leads, would you pray about that if God wants me to walk through Matthew chapter 24 and 25, because it involves the what's called the Olivet Discourse. And this is the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what we're getting ready, let me put it in context. It's always important that we study God's Word in context. As Jesus is going to deliver what we're getting ready to read, I want you to understand that the cross is simply a few days away. Only a few days away. Now, let's play a little Jeopardy as we begin the message this morning. Alex Trebek, I'll be Alex Trebek, and you can be the contestant, and maybe you're going to choose strange Bible titles for $500, Alex. And the question would be, or what would be on the block would be Olivet Discourse. And so the question is, why is it that they call this the Olivet Discourse? I know I'm not supposed to sort of word it that way, but then you would respond by, what is that which Jesus taught as he sat on the Mount of Olives? Boy, I really butchered that, didn't I? You can tell I'm not a real big Jeopardy fan. But what I'm trying to get you to understand this morning is, why do they call it the Olivet Discourse? Well, Jesus, during this Passion Week leading up to the cross, he's now leaving Jerusalem, and he's making his way back to Bethany. And as he's making his way back to Bethany, he stops there at the Mount of Olives. He sits, and he begins to teach his disciples. And so that's what we're going to be studying this morning. And what we're studying, it focuses on the coming judgment from the Messiah, and it deals with Christ's return. And so what Jesus is going to do here is Jesus is going to give his followers a glimpse of the end of the age. Now, I'm going to say this several times during the message, but so let me just start and give me, if you would, the allowance of repeating what I'm going to say. What we're getting ready to read and what we're getting ready to study in Matthew chapter 24, we're going to be in verses 1 through 14, key verse being verse 8. But what we're getting ready to study this morning, it is important to recognize that Jesus' teaching in this lesson, in this discourse, is in reference to Israel primarily and not the church. So what Jesus is doing, he is speaking of God's future program, God's future plans for Israel, Jerusalem, the temple then and the temple to come. Now, what's God's program for the church then? You say, Pastor, if you're going to be teaching about something that doesn't deal with the church, why should I listen? Well, number one, it's God's word. But number two, I want you to understand what God is doing here. God is highlighting, or maybe you would term shadowing, of the events that are to come. Things that we can expect to see as we approach the tribulation, As we approach the rapture, as we approach the end times, and the Bible, the Lord Jesus himself describes this as birth pains. So, God's program for the church, we know, is the rapture. The Olivet Discourse, what we're studying here this morning, does not deal in any way with the rapture. So, as we take our Bibles and we begin to look in Matthew chapter 24, beginning in verse 1, let's go ahead and read verses 1 and 2, and then let's come back and understand what Jesus is doing here and what he's teaching. As Jesus left Jerusalem, remember, we've talked about that. Jesus is leaving Jerusalem and was going out of the temple. His disciples came up and called his attention to its buildings. He, Jesus, replied to them, "Do you see all of these things? Truly, I tell you," and I underline that because this is Jesus saying, "I'm telling you something, pay attention, absolute truth, not one stone will be left here on another that will not be thrown down." So Jesus is leaving the temple. And if you read over in Matthew chapter 23, you find out that Jesus has been in a rather heated discussion, a debate with the Jewish religious leaders. And as I told you, he's leaving now Jerusalem and the temple area. Well, obviously the disciples have been with him, and they've been listening to the things that he has been saying to the Pharisees and the religious leaders there in Jerusalem. And what the disciples had heard, it was still a message that was burning in their ears, because Jesus had denounced the nation. And Jesus said that it, Israel, Jerusalem, the temple, would be desolate. In other words, doomed for destruction. Matthew 23. If Israel, Jerusalem, and the temple are destroyed, then the disciples, the followers of Jesus, are saying, then how would there be a nation for the Messiah to rule over? So they're confused. And they have these questions. And so what do the disciples do? The disciples point out to Jesus these magnificent buildings. Probably looked something like this, by the way. On our trip to Israel, they had a model that gave us a wonderful display of what Jerusalem would have looked like during the day of the Lord Jesus. And I look here and I see Herod's temple, and I see the layout of Jerusalem. And so the disciples are saying to Jesus, "But Jesus, we've heard the doom and gloom. We've heard the destruction. But Jesus, look at these magnificent buildings. Surely you don't mean that they're going to fall, especially, God, you're referencing here the temple itself." Now, Jesus, his response will bring them great concern, because Jesus tells them, yeah, the temple will be destroyed and Jerusalem with it. So what are the disciples doing? They're doing what we like to do in the American church. We focus on the building, or we focus on a religious system. And so they're focusing on the temple, and they're focusing what they knew to be a religious system. And yes, it was corrupted in that day. A temple and a system that Jesus had pronounced destruction and doom to. And what Jesus was doing now was reminding them and teaching them that the true center of a relationship with God, between God and man, was shifted from religion to more so the Lord Jesus himself. So in chapter 23, here's what I want you to pick up and understand. Jesus has already insisted to Israel and to the religious leaders. He says, "What you do with me, Jesus, will determine the future of you as individuals, will determine the future of this temple, and will determine the future of Israel itself." Now verse 2 there, Jesus is forecasting the destruction of the temple complex that Herod the Great had built. By the way, Herod had started building this around 20 BC, and it's completed fully in its finished form around 64 AD. So Herod and those after had been working on this for quite some time. Now, the temple, let me give you some background information. The temple that Jesus is speaking of here when he says, I'm telling you, not one stone will be left here on another that will be not be thrown down. The temple was made of huge stones. And on our trip to the Holy Land this past summer, we had an opportunity to see these huge stones, and they are massive. Some of the foundational stones of the temple in that day were larger than a bus. I mean, these were massive stones. And some of them many tons in size, carved out in the stone quarries underneath the city of Jerusalem. Such large stones could only be dislodged by deliberate force. The sad fulfillment, though, of what Jesus had spoken of would happen in 70 AD. And that is only 6 years after the temple itself was completed. So 6 years after the temple is completed, 64 AD, 70 AD, what happens? The Roman soldiers deliberately destroy the temple, prying the stones one by one and then casting them into the valley below. Very interesting here. The temple was burned, the gold in the temple melted in the fire and ran down into the cracks between the stones. As people later searched for the gold, they toppled every stone from its place. This, the destruction of the temple, the destruction of Jerusalem, was a foreshadowing of what was yet to come. And I'm just going to throw a scripture out there to you, Zechariah 14. So hopefully you've got the context now. You understand what's happening as Matthew chapter 24 is unfolding and Jesus is getting ready to teach the disciples. But as you can imagine, after what the disciples have heard, verse 3 tells us something interesting. After hearing this prophecy of doom and destruction, it prompted the disciples to do what you and I would do, and that is, Jesus, question. Got a question for you. So look there in verse 3. While he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples approached him. By the way, Mark is going to tell us who these disciples were. Peter, James, John, and Andrew, Mark chapter 13, they pull him to the side, and they have these questions for the Lord Jesus. The disciples approached him privately and said, tell us, when will these things happen, and what is the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? Now, these two questions are going to lead Jesus into what we know as the Olivet Discourse, or this teaching on the coming return and the judgment of the Messiah. So let me repeat what I've been saying before. Here is these disciples, Jewish men, are asking their Jewish rabbi, Jesus, the coming Messiah, these questions. And so understanding the context, the questions that they are relating to Jesus, the questions that we're reading right now that are on the screen or that are in your Bibles, these questions here are related to the destruction of the temple and Jerusalem and the sign of Jesus' second coming, his second advent at the end of the age. They have nothing to do with the church. Now understand that. If you're going to understand Matthew 24, you've got to understand that Jesus is going to answer the questions that's been posed to him. And as he answers the questions, he's dealing with what God's plan and future is for Israel. This isn't the church primarily. But I want you to know, and what we're going to see is even as Jesus is warning Israel about the coming tribulation, the Lord Jesus is also letting us know that as we see certain things happening in our world, we're beginning to notice these as birth pains. The contractions and all that would lead to the eventual birth of a child, or in this case, the coming of tribulation, and ultimately the Messiah. So the church is not present in Matthew chapter 24 and Matthew chapter 25. The Jewish disciples, the questions related to Jesus here are about Jerusalem, Israel, and their Messiah's coming in glory. Now, question number one that was asked to Jesus, when will these things, in other words, the temple and Jerusalem, remember, Jesus had already spoken of this earlier, and so the obvious question from them, question number one, Jesus, when are these things going to happen? when is the temple going to be destroyed? And when is Jerusalem going to be destroyed? Well, Matthew does not record Jesus' answer to the first question, but Luke did. And Luke tells us how Jesus answers this first question and the question that they're posing to him. Hey, when's the temple going to be destroyed? What are you talking about, Jesus? We heard what you said to the Pharisees just earlier, and now you're talking about no stone left here, one upon another. When's this going to happen? And Jesus said, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, and that's what's going to happen in AD 70 with the Roman army surrounds Jerusalem and then lowers Jerusalem, attacks Jerusalem and the temple, then recognize that its desolation has come near. Now, even as Jesus says this about what's going to happen in the near future, I believe this is also a reference to what's going to happen in the end times when Israel itself as a nation finds itself once again surrounded by enemies seeking its destruction. But Jesus is answering here the first question. Now, what about the second question? Question number two. Well, here's question number two. What is the sign of your coming in the end of the age? What's the sign? What should we be looking for? Now, again, it's important to recognize that Jesus is teaching in reference to Israel. Jesus is speaking, once again, not of the church, but of God's future program for Israel, the 70th week of Daniel, the tribulation period, where, remember, during the tribulation period, God turns his full focus toward Israel and toward the rebellious Gentiles. Now, God's program for the church. So what about the church, Pastor Rich? What's going to happen to the church? That's you, that's me, that's those of us who are living in this day and age. What happens to us? Well, God's program for the church concludes with the rapture. But it's not taught here in the Olivet Discourse. If you want to do some study about the rapture, let me give you some scripture. John chapter 14, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. If you want to study about the church and what's going to happen to the church and the rapture, I encourage you to take your Bibles this weekend and or this week and study. Now, so what are we to understand then about what Jesus is getting ready to describe? Because he's going to be answering this question as it relates to Israel. But as it relates to Israel, it also relates to the coming tribulation. Now, I happen to believe that the church is going to be raptured away before the tribulation period begins. And so what Jesus is going to do is Jesus is going to describe for his Jewish audience, his disciples, he's going to describe for them the things that are going to happen in the tribulation period, but he's also going to give the church an idea of the things that we can be looking for, I believe, as it leads up to the beginning of this tribulation period. So the disciples are thinking, let's see. Okay, we know about Zechariah 14, but Jesus is speaking about not only the destruction of Israel, or Jerusalem, I should say, in the temple in AD 70, but Jesus is also giving us a heads up of what Israel itself can expect. And so what he's doing here, and for the disciples, they're a little bit confused. They're thinking, okay, Jesus is talking about what's going to happen in the near future. Jesus is talking about what's going to happen in the end times. Jesus is it Zechariah 14 or what exactly? And so that's where they're at. They're a little bit confused, and so Jesus continues with his teaching. Verse 4 of Matthew chapter 24. Jesus replied to them. Remember, they've asked him the questions. Watch out that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name saying, I am the Messiah, and they will deceive many. Now, Jesus says, be careful. Because during this particular time, and as this leads up to this particular time, this time of judgment, the tribulation period, I believe it's a warning for the church today. I believe it's a warning for for those even who make their way and unfortunately endure and are part of the tribulation. Jesus says, be careful, because deception will be great. Hey, I want to say something to the church today. I believe it's really important that we understand that we're living in a day and age of great deception. Things are not as they always appear. And I'm wondering what might happen next to even cause many in the church to fall away or to walk away from their faith in Jesus Christ. Well, if it were true faith, they would never leave in the first place. But I want you to understand the warning that Jesus gives us, and I want to speak to all Christians today. Be very careful. So in a time such as this, for a time such as this, it's important that we know our Bibles. It's important that we spend time in God's Word. It's important that we're memorizing portions of the Bible as we're studying in our D groups together. It's important that we're praying and praying often. Praying without ceasing, as the Bible says. Because understand, Satan, his demons, this worldly system that we live in is going to be coming at us and offering deception after deception after deception. And our prayer is, oh God, give us wisdom. Oh Holy Spirit, give us discernment so that we are able to understand the times unto which we live. So that we're able to understand that this is not true and this is not true, but this is true. Because it's rooted, it's founded in the Word of God. So Jesus is telling His disciples of that which is to come, but I believe it's a word for the church today. And that is, be very careful, watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in My name saying, I am the Messiah, and they will seek to deceive you. Now notice what happens next. Jesus continues, you're going to hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed. Because these things must take place. But the end is not yet. So he's speaking now in reference to the tribulation period, certainly. But what about the events that the church will notice before we are raptured away? Jesus said, these events that you notice could be referred to as birth pains, the shadowing of things to come. Verse 7, for nation will rise up against nation and kingdom against kingdom. We're noticing that today, aren't we? There will be famines and earthquakes. And Luke mentions in Luke 21, verse 11, as he's giving his account here under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of what Jesus said. And Jesus also mentioned, Luke lets us know that he's speaking of pestilences and plagues in various places that will come. I've been doing some reading this past week. And I've just been asking the question, you know, okay, the coronavirus, what does it have to do with end-time prophecy? I came across an article. It's by Britt Gillette. It's interesting. It was just published a few days ago. How the coronavirus sets the stage. Now, that's interesting. Sets the stage for the end times. Here's what Britt Gillette says. The word coronavirus doesn't appear in the Bible. And what we see now is not one of the events of the tribulation. So Mr. Gillette is already letting us know we're not in the tribulation period. But he goes on. However, the coronavirus is one of the general signs Jesus said to look for. And it sets the stage for the rapture of the church and the arrival of the tribulation. When asked to describe the signs of His coming, Jesus cited pandemics, just like the one we're experiencing now, as a major sign, Luke chapter 21, verse 11. But this wasn't the only sign he said to look for. He said, look for the Jewish people back in the land of Israel. Jeremiah 23. Check. He said, look for the Jewish people also to have possession of Jerusalem. Check. He said, look for the gospel, the good news being preached to the ends of the earth. All right. That's happening. And then he continues, we see all these signs today, and Jesus commanded us to watch for them. He warned us not to be found sleeping when the master arrives without warning. And then he says this, he concludes, the coronavirus is God's wake-up call to those who have been sleeping. It sets the stage. There it is, birth pains, shadows. It sets the stage for the rapture of the church, the arrival of the Antichrist, and the second coming of Jesus Christ, and that's at the end of the 7 years of tribulation. And then he concludes, make sure you're not asleep. Wow. That article caused me to think even more so. And I hope it does you. So here's the question. Pastor Rich, what are you saying? I really believe we're living in interesting times. And I believe what we're beginning to notice are shadows, things that set the stage for the coming of the Lord Jesus, the rapture of the church, the tribulation period. I saw this slide. I just wanted to share it with you. TrackingBibleProphecy.org, 1935 through 2019. It's a slide that just speaks to the frequency of earthquakes, the different sizes of earthquakes and their frequencies. And the obvious thing to notice here is that they have certainly been on the increase. But now I just put that out there to you for something for you to ask. Could this be another sign of birth pains? Now we get to verse 8. And here is what Jesus said. As he's been describing all of the things that are going to be happening, Jesus says in verse 8, all these events are the beginning of labor or birth pains. Now, as a pregnant woman has birth pains to indicate that her baby will soon be born, what the scripture is teaching us here is, so will all of these different signs and conflicts and catastrophes, they're going to be leading to, they're letting us know of that which is to come. I remember this story. Right after my sister Laura had been killed in a car accident, she was 15 years old, and our family was obviously shaken. Now, this happened, what I'm getting ready to tell you, oh, goodness, some 30 years ago. So my memory is a little fuzzy, but there are certain parts of the story that I don't forget. We went to church shortly after her funeral, and there was a guest preacher, speaker there. It was our music minister. His name, Calvin Bolton. I think our normal pastor, Ray Webb, had been away for that particular Sunday. And I'll never forget that Calvin stood there in the pulpit that Sunday morning, and he was wanting to give words of comfort to the church, to our community, to our families that had been involved in the car accident. And I'll never forget that as he tried to make sense of and give encouragement to us all, he gave this illustration at the end of his sermon. He, being a music man, he used a musical illustration. Now, I always love to sing in the choir. I don't know a lot about music. I don't even know what I'm getting ready to describe to you. It has a term, but I don't know what it is. But what I remember when we would sing in the choir, you would be hitting that last note. And you would hold that last note until the music director did this. I don't know what you call that. I don't know what it's called. You probably do. I don't. But I remember you'd be holding that last note. Ah. And when that happened, you stopped. You stopped singing, right? And I'll never forget Calvin. He really spoke to my heart that Sunday morning because he said, it's as though what we see happening in our world today is letting us know that things are beginning to wind toward an end. And literally, he began to describe God in heaven with his hands in this fashion as we began to see certain events unfolding, that God himself is beginning to bring it all to an end. And I think that's what Jesus is teaching us and giving us understanding about when he says, pay attention. Pay attention to the church, he says, pay attention. To the Jewish people, he says, pay attention. To the world itself, he says, pay attention. And by the way, this is an interesting slide. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it this morning, but there's an interesting correlation between Revelation chapter 6 and what Jesus is speaking of here in the Olivet Discourse. And what happens in Revelation chapter 6 is what's going to happen during the tribulation period. And it's interesting, as Jesus is walking them through, this is why I believe that as Jesus is describing to his disciples these events, he's literally telling them, this is what's going to happen during the 7 years of tribulation, but be ready, because there are going to be certain things that you begin to notice that give evidence that the time is drawing near. So the birth pains will start before the tribulation, I believe, on a smaller scale. But they're going to begin to increase. And it will culminate into certain specific judgments with global consequences during the tribulation period. So back to verse 9. Jesus, again, is letting his disciples know. They've asked the question, when are these things going to happen? Well, that was about the temple and the destruction of Jerusalem. And we know that most of that occurred during AD 70. I think there's more to come, and that'll be during the tribulation period and the end times. But I'm just going to leave that at that for now. Verse 9, though, then he says, then they will hand you over to be persecuted, and they will kill you. People believe this is the actual beginning of the tribulation period. What he's been describing will happen during the tribulation, but the other things were birth pains. You will be hated by all nations because of my name. Then many will fall away, betray one another, and hate one another. You know, we're beginning to see a shadow of what Jesus is speaking about here to the Jews. We're beginning to notice this very thing is happening even in our culture as we're headed toward the end times. Then he says in verse 11 and verses 12, many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. There's that word again, deceive, deceive, deceive. Oh, church, let's not be an easy target for deception. But instead, let's spend our time in God's Word. Let's be students of God's Word. Let's be, if you would, scholars of God's Word. Because we understand we must be in the Word for a time such as this. And the Bible even tells us that the deception is going to come both from the world, and it's going to come from even inside the church. How about that? And Jesus said, test the spirits, church. Be ready to determine whether or not they acknowledge that Jesus is the Messiah. So we're going to be careful during these times. And we're going to be asking this question. What's happening? And is it meant to deceive the church and to take our focus off of the Great Commission and off of the gospel of Jesus Christ? So we're testing the spirits, and we're asking that. We're even listening closely to what people might say inside the church. Does it take us away from the Lord Jesus Christ? We're listening to what others are saying outside the church, and we're careful to discern, and we're asking, God, give us wisdom here as we proceed forward. Verse 13 and verse 14. These are the concluding verses of the passage we're studying this morning. But the one who endures, verse 13, to the end, will be saved. So we understand true salvation endures. Christians, true Christians, they don't give up. Our hope is found in Jesus Christ and in nothing else. And then in verse 14, he says, this good news of the kingdom will be proclaimed in all the world as a testimony to all nations. Then the end will come. And much of that proclamation is going to happen in the tribulation period. I get that. The witnesses, the 144,000, and all that's going to be happening. I mean, the gospel is going to continue to go forth in a very mighty and special way during the tribulation time. But even now, we see the good news of Jesus being carried out via technology, via internet, via different ways to the uttermost parts of the earth. So one clear indicator that will signify the coming of the end times is when the gospel is proclaimed throughout the whole world. Now let me ask you this question. We're going to wrap it up. Jesus has already, in Matthew 23, he insisted to the religious leaders. The religious leaders were pronouncing their faith and their commitment to a temple and to religion, a religious system. But Jesus comes on the scene as the Son of God, and Jesus is saying to have a true relationship with the God who created you, you must know the one that God has sent, the true Messiah, and that is Jesus himself. So Jesus has been explaining this, and Jesus says, right before he gives this teaching, he says to the Pharisees, and he says to the nation of Israel, to Jerusalem, he says, let me tell you something. What's going to determine your future, the future of this temple, and the future of Jerusalem and Israel itself, is what you do with me, Jesus. That's a great word for the church today to remember. Our message is Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And so the question we pose as the church to a world looking for answers, the question we pose is this: what do you say of Jesus? What say you of Jesus? Who is Jesus to you? Where is your trust? And where is your faith? What are you depending upon as we see the events unfolding, as we see ourselves beginning to notice events in our world that are being described in the Bible, events that are telling us that tribulation is coming, events that's telling us that the rapture of the church is soon to take place. And so we're asking the question, what say you of Jesus? Do you know him as your personal Savior? Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ in a very intimate way, such that you love him, you follow him, you understand that it was his death on the cross that paid the penalty, the price of your sin, my sin, and that's made a way that you and I can spend eternity in heaven. Eternity in heaven with God. What say you of Jesus? Jesus was warning the religious leaders of that day, and he's warning us today, what say you of me? That's the ultimate question. The ultimate question. Here are the words of Jesus as we close. This is Mark chapter 13, beginning in verse 33. The stage is being set, is what Jesus, I believe, is relating there in the Olivet Discourse. The birth pains are already being felt. And Christians are commanded by Jesus to do what? Well, let's read. Watch, Jesus says. Be alert, for you don't know when the time is coming. It is like a man on a journey who left his house, gave authority to his servants, gave each one his work, and commanded the doorkeeper to be alert. Verse 35. Therefore, Jesus says it again, for such a time as this, be alert. Therefore, be alert, since you don't know when the master of the house is coming. whether in the evening or at midnight or at the crowing of the rooster or early in the morning. Otherwise, when he comes suddenly, he might find you sleeping. And what I say to you, I say to everyone. Be alert, Jesus says. Be alert. So as we notice the things that are happening in our world, I believe that what we're seeing is the grace and mercy of God that is allowing us to see the storm that is approaching. The birth pains, if you would. Last night, there was a bad storm in the area, right? Remember? And there's a picture of us floating on the internet. Jennifer mentioned we were huddled there in the little bathroom in our home. Tornado warnings had been issued. Well, how did I know the storm was coming? I mean, it was dark outside. It was nighttime. So I couldn't see the dark clouds, but I'm sure they were forming. Began to notice the wind was starting to pick up. But then we started getting text messages from friends who were saying, we're noticing that there's a storm, possibly a tornado that's heading your way. Be ready. We pulled up the news, Channel 7, and Channel 7 was saying, be ready. There in the area which you live, be ready. The weather radar on our computers was telling us, the storm is approaching, be ready. My iPhone started dinging with alerts that said, storm, major storm, tornado warning, be ready. And you know what? I believe that's what we see happening in our world today. We see these events that are happening, things that are unfolding, and we can't make sense out of it. And as we begin to notice and as we read God's word, as Jesus is even preparing the nation of Israel for that which is to come, I believe he's allowing us, the church, to see these birth pains and the coming storm that is headed our way. I want to close with this article. I found it on a website I like to frequent from time to time. It's called Rapture Ready. Here's what the writer says. The year 2020 has been such a disaster. It will likely take some time to figure out what it all means. The coronavirus and the financial meltdown will dominate how people are remembering this year, 2020. But he says there is a third calamity taking place in Africa that is currently on the second page of news stories. But it has my attention, he said, because of its biblical connection. A massive swarm of locusts has invaded at least 8 countries. About a month ago, this cloud of insects was declared the worst plague of locusts in 70 years. This infestation of desert locusts arrived first in East Africa last June, attacking crops and pasture land. They came from the portion of the Arabian Peninsula, which is normally bone dry. In 2018, two perfectly timed cyclones dumped heavy rains in the region, creating the ideal wet, sandy conditions the desert locusts require to breed. And that's what they did. 3 generations of breeding occurred in only 9 months, causing locust numbers to increase by 8,000 times. Scientists say that the favorable wet conditions due to the above average rainfall of this season mean that 2 more of new breeding generations of these locusts by June should happen, and that's going to increase the population size by up to 400 times. Now, what does that mean? A typical swarm of locusts consists of about 150 million locusts per square kilometer. A 1 square kilometer locust swarm is capable of consuming the same amount in one day as approximately 35,000 people. Just a typical swarm. And the coronavirus is harming the effort to come against, to combat the swarm of locusts. And so here's his prediction. A year from now, we will likely be writing articles about the Great Famine of 2021. There in East Africa. And it talks about the food shortages that will happen as a result of the locusts. It is widely believed in the pre-tribulation rapture camp, which I am, that we are only to see the birth pains up until the rapture takes place, not the wrath. Birth pains, then the rapture, then the wrath of God comes. And what I love about this article is he's even making reference to something else with a biblical connection. And that is, even in our world today, these locusts now that have appeared. Since God is always trying to get man's attention with calamity, he said, I think what we are seeing is a shadow of what will unfold during the tribulation hour. And he concludes, I warn all salvation fence sitters to repent now to avoid a far greater wrath that is to come. My friend J.R. Jolly is going to come and sing a beautiful song for us as we close, Midnight Cry. It's always been one of my favorites. It's a song that reminds us that Jesus is coming, and Jesus is coming soon. And the point of the Olivet Discourse for the church, remember, the primary audience was the Jews. But for the church, Jesus is letting us know, you're going to begin to notice some things. Birth pains. You're going to begin to notice that the stage is set for the rapture, the tribulation, and the second coming of the Lord Jesus. Are you ready? Seriously, are you ready? Come on, you can't be asleep right now. You got to notice these times that we live. Wow, are you ready? Father, in Jesus' name, God, begin to open hearts and open eyes such that we might understand the times in which we live. In Jesus' name, amen.
I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind. And it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call that the midnight cry will be going home. When Jesus steps out on a cloud to call his children, the dead in Christ shall rise to meet him in the air. And in those that remain shall be quickly changed at the midnight cry. when Jesus comes again. I look around me, I see prophecies of the day they're fulfilling. Oh, and the signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. I can almost hear my Father as he says, son, go get my children. And at the midnight cry, when Jesus steps out on a cloud to call his children, the dead in Christ shall rise to meet him in the air. And then those that remain shall be quickly changed. At the midnight cry, oh, at the midnight cry, at the midnight cry, when Jesus comes again.
Greatest gift we could ever give anyone. Maybe you've heard something today in the message and you have decided you need a relationship with him. If that is something you would like to talk about, please reach out to us at decision@crossroadsbaptist.org or call the church office and we will make sure that someone contacts you as soon as possible. If you would like to help this ministry as we share Christ and support our community, please go to our website, crossroadsbaptist.org, and click on the Give tab. Hey, let's go be the church that Jesus has called us to be. See you next time.